Namaste, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. We will be continuing with our series of talks for Indian spires. The next topic is one of the most complex, but one of the most interesting and having the most profound consequences. It's called the myth of the Aryan invasion, or addressing the Aryan question relative to the history of India, not just the invasion scenario, but all the relevant scenarios that have gone along with it. One of the greatest discoveries in modern intellectual thought was around the 18th century, when scholars in Europe discovered that their languages were closely connected to the Sanskrit language. The Sanskrit language was an older and more sophisticated language than the languages they spoke. Not only the modern Slavic, Germanic, Romance languages, but the older Greek, Latin, Celtic, and even Persian languages. So confronted with that, some of them felt that Sanskrit was the mother of all languages, and India was the mother of civilization, or even of what could be called Western culture. Shortly thereafter, the colonial era in India continued, and it became increasingly clear to the Western mind that this connection with India was suspect to their own independence and also to the originality of their own thought. And so there was a gradual movement away from that and a projection of the idea that there was some earlier, what they called proto-Indo-European languages, from which even Sanskrit derived, and actually relative to one of perhaps the most ancient forms was actually German, much older than even the Sanskrit. So what happened was these languages became part of the German and the European nationalism of the 19th century. And along with that, the term Aryan was used to characterize not only these original languages, but the so-called original group of people, which were hypothesized in the beginning as an ethnicity, a race, even predominantly blonde-haired, blue-eyed people. And so the Aryan theory arose both through language and ethnicity, and is very intimately connected with European nationalism, not only Germany, even as far as Russia, even other countries involved in the region. At the same time, there was the Indology in the 19th century. It's curious, in the 18th century, European scholars, for example, Voltaire, were much more positive about India and its traditional thought. As the colonial era developed, colonially funded government scholars came up with increasingly negative views of the Indian culture, its literature, and also its history and antiquity. Most known, of course, was Max Müller. And in their examination of the Indian teachings, they did try to find out what was the oldest layer of the Indian thought. But when they found that oldest layer of the Indian thought, they came to the conclusion that it wasn't Indian. And they brought in methods of interpretation that were outside of the Indian tradition, and even contrary to what the Indian tradition said. Their main focus was the older Vedic text, namely the Rigveda. And their main tool of approaching Rigveda was their own tools of comparative European mythology, which they call, and of course, linguistic studies. And their conclusion was that the Vedas resembled the old folk literature of Europe, and they must have been developed in Europe or Central Asia and brought in and imposed upon the people of India. Traditional means in India of interpreting Vedic texts through Upanishads, through brahmanas, through rituals, through spiritual meanings, even through literature, were rejected. So the Vedas were essentially taken out of India and reinterpreted in a Western Indological image in which they were regarded as inferior to the Bible, on par with even European mythology, but maybe even in some ways inferior to that. And along with that, Proto-Indo-European idea was that these languages then could not have arisen in India. They must have come from Central Asia, and their original culture would have been primitive nomadic people, and later warrior people who with horses and chariots spread their languages throughout the various cultures of the world. So in other words, this theory did not develop overnight, and it had political ramifications from the beginning and colonial support from the beginning. In fact, you can read it very clearly in Monia Williams' very nice Sanskrit-English dictionary. In his own introduction, which is there, he says, we're doing this so that we can show what Indian thought really is and allow people to convert to Christianity. We will show the superiority of our Christian ideas. At that time, there was nothing hidden about these ideas. The colonial agenda, the missionary agenda, the missionary assault on India and the rest of the world, the non-Christian world, was in full swing, had support from all the churches, it had support from the governments, and made no qualifications about what they intended to do. They believed in the superiority of Indian culture. They rejected traditional Indian interpretation of the Vedas. They rejected Indian interpretation of history altogether, anything more than before the time of Buddha, if not even after that. They put out the conclusion India had no history, or Indian texts were historically invalid, or they were mixed with mythology. Not that Greek texts weren't mixed with mythology, or the Bible is not mixed with religious imagery. So they threw out that whole tradition, and they kind of pretended that the Vedas were something they could understand and the Hindus could not. Now at that time, there was not much archaeological work having been done in India. So they came to the conclusion that these Vedic Indo-European people, who were likely blonde-haired and blue-eyed, came into India around 1500 BC and civilized what had been a very primitive culture of basically aboriginal people. Some even went further and said that there were no cities or civilization in India before the time of Alexander, that it was the Greeks who had civilized India. But in any case, that was the scenario up into the 20th century. Western Aryans, Vedic people, came into India and brought civilization. That was the scenario. And also in Europe, these Aryans, the other interesting thing about the Aryans in Europe, it allowed groups like the Germans to connect back to their own older mythology and dissociate with Christianity and Judaism as their origins. So there was a certain amount of anti-Semitism also already then. Hitler did not invent anti-Semitism. It's as old as Europe. Several crusades occurred in Europe against the Jews during the Middle Ages. The French and the British threw out all the Jews from that part of Europe in the 13th century, and the Spanish at the time of the Inquisition did the same. So Europe had created this glorious new Aryan identity for itself, particularly via Germany, and India was made as an offshoot of that, and the glory of Sanskrit was kind of forgotten or put in the background. Then in the 20th century, archaeologists began to find significant urban ruins in India, largely near the Indus River, which they called the Indus Valley Civilization, they named after the two main cities they discovered, Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa. Curiously, this dated from the 3rd millennium BC, which was 1,000 up to 2,000 years earlier than they were willing to allow civilization as having existed in India. And then, of course, it contradicted their Aryan theory, because India was civilized then, It wasn't civilized by the Aryans coming in. So they reinvented the Aryans as the destroyers of the Indus Valley culture, and turned them from the bringers of civilization to the destroyers of civilization, and created this and extended this Aryan invasion theory, with Aryans coming in and plundering and destroying and putting an end to this civilization. One of the archaeologists, Wheeler, concurred, and he piled a bunch of skeletons together and said, this is proof of the Aryans having killed everybody. And this theory was then ingrained in textbooks throughout the world, and you can still find it in many textbooks throughout the world. There were contrary voices even then. In the late 19th century, a British archaeologist named Oldham did extensive studies of ancient rivers in India and found there was an ancient river called Saraswati that on which a lot of these ancient civilizations were connected. Saraswati is also a river known in the Vedas. And he even suggested that this was more the Saraswati culture, but the predominant archaeologist disagreed and did not counter or accept that view. One thing we must remember, the ability to find sites archaeologically and the ability to interpret them are two totally different skills. The fact that Wheeler was one of the first people to find the sites does not mean that his interpretation of them had to be correct. They are not related skills at all. Archaeologists can show ruins. They are not necessarily qualified to interpret them. And these archaeologists had no training in the Indian tradition and no study of the Indian history. And so there was no question of them finding something there that they were not aware of to begin with. Now, since the partition of India, archaeology has continued and continued to develop in various ways. Two most important areas, geological survey of India has mapped out the old course of the Saraswati River in hundreds of studies, and archaeology has also examined that. Saraswati was a great river of India that dried up around 4,000 years ago. Most of these so-called Harappan or Indus Valley sites are actually located on the dried banks of the Saraswati River, showing there was once water that was located there. And more recent archaeology in Haryana has now discovered these Harappan sites and pre-Harappan sites of agriculture going back to 7,000 BC. So in other words, the whole development of civilization in India can be traced along the Saraswati River. For those who know the Vedic text, in Rigveda, Saraswati is a great river flowing into the sea. In late Vedic text into Mahabharata, there's the Vinashana of the Saraswati, where it dries up in the desert. And then later on, Saraswati is not mentioned at all. So all stages of the drying up of the river are also there. Unfortunately, another event happened in historical studies in India. After the independence of India, the leftist, predominantly Marxist, took over the historical department. Marx was against the traditional culture of India, and he tried to turn class war theory of Europe into caste war theory of India. And the Marxists had invested themselves in the Aryan invasion theory, as the Aryan is the foreign white-skinned casteist people who impose themselves upon the country. So when these discoveries started to come out, the Marxists were quite upset. It went against their theories, so they tried to discredit them. They tried to say that these people who brought out these theories were Hindu fundamentalists. Or it was a different Saraswati river that was there in the Vedas. And it was a false identification that occurred later. They developed a whole series of negation. But as the archaeology proceeded, it also became clear that this Indus, or what we call Saraswati culture, was not destroyed by outside invaders. Wheeler's massacre at Mohenjo-Daro, as Bibi Lal and others proved, was just a mixing up of skeletons. They came from different levels. They died at different ages, and none of the other sites had any evidence of being destroyed by outside invaders. The civilization came to an end largely because of the change of the water courses with the drying up of the Saraswati River. And since then, now there are at least five sites larger than Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa. The largest site is a site called Rakigari in Kurukshetra itself. It has not been well excavated, but it has, the excavation has gone on there to some degree. And as the excavation of these so-called Harappan sites has continued, very many interesting things have been found. First of all, relative to extent, there are numerous sites extending from Gujarat almost to Mumbai, all the way across Sindh to what is now Iran, north through Haryana, Sindh, even parts of Rajasthan, western UP, Punjab, even all the way some sites in Afghanistan itself. And they have, they constitute the largest urban civilization in the ancient world in terms of size. You could take the Indus-Saraswati civilization and put all of Egypt and Mesopotamia together and still have extra room left over. We talk of Sumeria as the cradle of civilization. All of Sumeria could be put in a small portion of Gujarat by that whole Surat region. There'd be plenty of room left over. So much larger in size, much more populated. It had probably 5-10 times the population of the Mesopotamian cultures, and a greater uniformity of building practices and artifacts, arts, and crafts. So a very interesting situation has occurred. Now, to go back to the Vedas are by far the largest ancient literature we have from the ancient world. What the Greeks have preserved is much later and much smaller. What the Bible and those traditions are much smaller. What you have in the Mesopotamian culture, what they found is only a few isolated texts. We have by far the largest literature from the ancient world, but preserved throughout history with extensive commentaries and redactions. Even the tradition is the Vedas that we have that are compiled are the 28th compilation, not the first. We have all the ancient Rigveda, we have Yajurveda, Atharvaveda, Samaveda, we have the Brahmanas, the Aranyakas, Upanishads, different recensions, and then all connected to Mahabharatas, to Sutra literature, the largest literature from the ancient world, most of it before, at least a lot of it before the time of Buddha by anybody's account. And yet we are told that this was a literature of nomadic people and primitive people, which there's no reason to preserve that type of literature in any case. So the point I raised in one of my earlier books, it's been elevated to something now people sometimes call Frawley's paradox. India has the largest literature from the ancient world. It has the largest archaeological evidence, urban sites from the ancient world. Both are centered on what is called the Saraswati River. Why not just connect the two? Then the mystery of a civilization without a literature and a literature without a civilization is solved. But they don't want to do it because that undermines the Aryan theory. It questions European nationalism. It questions Marxism. Now it even questions Dravidian nationalism. And of course, it gives a lot of trouble for the linguists who have placed the Vedic culture in Central Asia under linguistic grounds. So over the last, I've been involved in writing on this for about 25 years. So over the last, we produced many books, but over the last few decades, the evidence has become progressively in our favor. No evidence of any such invasion has been found. So then they decided to reinvent the theories in Aryan migration theory. These Aryans migrated in, and they didn't actually disrupt the culture. The problem is, and there was no evidence of migration either. To date, there is not one archaeological site that can be associated with incoming, invading, or migrating Aryans. There is no set of skeletons anywhere showing these people. There is no set of artifacts, horses, chariots, bones of anything. There's absolutely nothing in the archaeological record that they can use to produce or to prove either an Aryan invasion or much less an Aryan migration. And yet we know the languages, the culture of India throughout the subcontinent have this Vedic and Sanskritic connection. Some have tried to go, and also genetically speaking, there were some early genetic studies they tried to twist and say that Indian population has a lot of genes from Central Asia. But the more recent genetic study shows that is not the case. There was more of an outflow of genetic information out from India out. There is no inflow of populations in the time of this so-called Aryan invasion, Aryan migration at all. So then they have come to the point where they say, well, the migration was in small enough numbers that it did not need to be recorded in the genetic information. So one of our friends politely and humorously called it the Aryan invasion, migration, trickle-down tourist theory. Aryan tourists came in and changed the nature of the culture. And of course, there are countries. If you go to Turkey, the Turkish people speak a Turkish language, but ethnically they're not Turkish people. They're the same old Greek and Anatolian people who the Turkish language has came in over time. There are instances where languages come in and the population doesn't change. But there is nothing as radical as the case of India. And in those cases, the earlier languages, earlier place names, etc., are known. In northern India, there are no pre-Sanskritic place names at all of rivers and other things. So the only card they have left to prove Aryan invasion migration is what they call the linguist card. They claim that the languages of India came in from Central Asia and are connected because of their connection with Iranian and other languages. So it's a linguistic theory at this point. Archaeologically, geologically speaking, there is no evidence. But even linguistically, the linguists don't entirely agree, and linguistic information is always questionable, and it requires harder data to prove it. You know, they've had this idea of language families and then the tree of language. So they say, okay, tree of language, there was some primitive Proto-Indo-European language spoken by these nomadic people in Central Asia. They gradually spread over time. One wave went to Europe, one wave went to Iran, one wave went to India, and that is how it has occurred. But actually, if we look at language, that is not the case. Let's look at Indo-European languages. We have related languages of French, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese. Why? Because there were migrating nomads who took these languages to different places? No, because there's a dominant Latin-Roman culture that ruled these areas and passed on their languages. So in history, we've had very powerful, besides spoken languages, we have lingua francas, we have languages of trade, we have languages of ruling states and languages of empire, languages of literature, languages of religion. This is what has allowed language to spread, not primitive people simply moving with their languages. So we have a history of Sanskrit as a lingua franca and dominant language, Persian, of course, Greek, Latin, Scythian languages once dominated what we call Central Asia and were the lingua franca. And we also have a very good criticism of the whole linguistic theory of human culture. Culture and language is usually not the same. For example, in Europe, there are also people speaking non-Indo-European languages that are part of European culture. In India, of course, you have the so-called Dravidian or non-Indo-European languages. The oldest cradle of civilization is said to be Sumeria, right? What is that? What happened to the Sumerian language? It was an isolated, dead language that after a few hundred years, nobody spoke. Mesopotamia has greater linguistic diversity than any other place in the world. It has Indo-European, Arabic, Caucasian, Sumerian, Hamitic languages, and yet they say civilization came from there. So the ability of languages to be spread or language families to exist doesn't rest upon migration of primitive people. It rests upon some elite predominance and dominant culture. And then we have to understand that when these throughout history, the majority of people have spoken more than one language. For example, in Hellenistic Greece, or actually the Greco-Roman world, Greek was the lingua franca in the east, and Latin was the lingua franca in the west. Aramaic was there. Local languages were there. So to identify people by one language is absurd, and to identify culture and ethnicity by language is absurd. In ancient times, you had a lot of linguistic diversity because you had different communities. The trading community had certain type of language, military community, and priestly community. And then what we have with Vedic text is not the common spoken language. We have the chandas, we have the meter, we have the poetry. We have a poetic language much more refined than, say, Shakespeare, because it's a language that was refined and used for generations as a poetic and religious language. So there's no way of needing to say that at that time people only spoke this language, or no other languages existed. So the language evidence is also very weak. In fact, we can make a good case that because India had such a strong culture, that it influenced, like the predominance of Latin, Greek, and others, it influenced other cultures in various directions. And the fact is, as the oldest and most sophisticated of the Indo-European languages, it's the most in need of a great civilization to sustain it. The whole Vedic literature could only have existed if there was a large state machinery to maintain it. There needed to be the instrumentality of a state to continue so many different branches of knowledge, so many different recensions of the Vedas, and so many different types of vidyas going along with it. In fact, every aspect of the vidyas were there: architecture, music, dance, philosophy, religion, medicine, and so forth. All of these are under the broader umbrella of the Vedas. And then let's look at what the Vedas actually say. Geographically, Vedas talk of a region of Saptasindhu. But if you look at Saptasindhu, there are three rivers that they mention give the most predominance to: Sindhu, Saraswati, and Sarayu. These are rivers comparable to the ocean flowing to the sea. And it's very easy to identify these at the Sarayu in the east of India, the Saraswati in the center, and the Indus in the west. Some Western scholars tried to put Saraswati and Sarayu in Afghanistan because there are rivers in Afghanistan with connections to these Vedic names, because you also had these in the Iranian culture. But we all also have a history of Purus and Ikshwakus conquering, moving to Afghanistan. And because these rivers are said to be oceanic and huge, in the case of the Saraswati flowing all the way into the sea, we cannot identify them with the rivers of Afghanistan. What got me into this field of study, I started studying the Vedic yoga, we'll talk about that later today, and through the works of Sri Aurobindo in the Vedic text. And as I did that, I found out that the culture I saw in the Vedic text was very different than the culture that was said to be there. And one of the things I did, it's still in my book, God, Sages, and Kings, I cataloged, there's over 150 references to Samudra, or ocean, in Rigveda itself. Not only 150 references, there's a heavenly ocean, there's the Antariksha as the ocean, atmospheric ocean, earthly ocean, there's two oceans, there's four oceans, there's the metaphor of Shataritra, the ship with 100 oars, there's travel on the sea, there's also travel on the sea where Vasishtha prays, there's water all around me and I can't drink. Why? Because it's salt water. in the ocean. We have Vedic rishis like Vasishtha who talk about travel on the sea. And the Vedic rishi gotras like the Bhrigus from Varuna, who is the deity of the ocean. And the Vedic deities, the main Vedic myth is Indra. He slays the dragon Vritra at the foot of the mountain and releases the seven rivers to flow into the ocean. Agni Samudra Vasasam, Agni, the oceanic fire, which we have in the later Puranic literature, mentioned in Rigveda. Soma is mentioned as Mahasamudra, or Chatu Samudra, or the great ocean. We also have the famous site of the Somnath in Gujarat. Then we have Varuna, who is already an oceanic deity in the Rigveda itself. So the mythology or the image of the ocean pervades the Vedas, and it pervades the symbolism of both the gods and the rishis. Even Vasishtha, Agastya, Maitri, Varuni, they're born of Mitra and Varuna. Vasishtha has this enlightenment or realization while he's on a ship at sea where Varuna comes to him. Both Vasishtha and Agastya are born of the Kumbha or the pot, which is also the ship or the vessel. So that oceanic symbolism is there, and the rivers are there, and the idea of many mountain ranges, all these things are there. Then in the Vedic literature, we also have the references of kings, mainly starting with the five Vedic peoples. Well, first Manu, and that generation, Nahusha, his outshoots, and then the dividing of the region to the five regions, the Purus, the Yadus, the Anus, the Druyus, the Turvashas. Puranas specifically relate them to directions, Purus in the center, Turvasha southeast, Yadu southwest, Anus in the north, and Druyus in the west, which is where we find them in the literature. And then in the Vedas, even in Rigveda, there are certain battles going on. And there are the battles between what are called so-called Aryas and Dasyus, or Dasas. So the Western scholar said, okay, this is the incoming Aryans versus the native Dravidian people. Aryans are suspect because they're connected to Jyoti, or light, and the sun, so they must be fair-skinned people. Dasyus are connected to darkness, and so they must be dark-skinned people. And so I did a study of all these so-called battles, particularly this Dasaragni, or the Battle of the Ten Kings in the Rig Veda. Battle of the Ten Kings, which is one of the ones they highlight, the main fight, the main people are a branch of the Purus called the Tritsus. They defeat enemies on two sides. One is Yamuna, and the other is Parushni, which is, I think, what is now called Ravi, or one of those rivers there, Punjab. And the interesting thing is, among the enemies, their enemies include Anus, Druyus, Turvashas, and another branch of the Purus. Even some Purus are there. And if you look throughout the Rig Veda, there's a certain struggle between the northern peoples, like the Purus, and the southern people, like Yadus, which we also have historically mentioned. In other words, these other Vedic people, Anus, Druyus, etc., could also be called Dasyus or Dasas. It had nothing to do with race or ethnicity. It was a matter of terminology. And even the term Das, one Vedic king, Sudas, other term Devodas, worshipper Dash. And so in Iranian language, Das also means a people, you know, also means a certain region. So as a division, it also exists there. In other words, there's no evidence. And then the funniest one they did is they said that, okay, these Arya people are fighting Dasyus, who are Shishna Devas. They worship the phallus. And therefore, they must be indigenous Dravidian Shaivites. And they are also said to be, to have Anasa. They are said to have low-nosed. So they are the low-nosed indigenous people. There are two references of this type in 1,000 hymns of Rig Veda. So then the interesting thing, I researched those out, and the Dasyus, who are Anasa, are also Apada and Ahasta. They have no feet, and they have no hands, and they have no nose. What kind of people are these? It's a description of a serpent, right? Serpents don't have any arms and legs, and they don't have a nose. So this is the type of scholarship that was used to interpret the Vedic text. Then we're told that these people were primitive. Then let's just look at the Vedic meters, the chandas. Meters from 24 to 48 syllables. There's three that are mainly mentioned, but others are there. Highly sophisticated metric language and alternation of long and short syllables. Mathematical terms are there in Rigveda. We have 360 as a common term, 108, a lot of these astronomical numbers, 12, 21, 180. In Yajurveda, we have names from numbers from Eka, Dasha, Shata, Sahasra, to one followed by 12 zeros after it in the Yajurveda Samhita itself. And we have tremendous sophistication. For example, in Shatapata Brahmana, they talk about 27 nakshatras, which are mentioned in the other text. But they say each of the 27 nakshatras should also be divided into 27 parts. That becomes a 720-fold division of the sky. We have mentions of great kings and great emperors. Often we have the statement that the king had 100,000 troops and he conquers 100 cities. So you can say that these are exaggerations, but they say there's... And then in the Aitareya Brahmana, which is a very interesting text, they mention the Chakravartins, who ruled India from sea to sea. They mentioned Vedic kings like Bharata and Sudas. They also mentioned their Vedic rishis, who were their purohits, like Vasishta or Dirghatamas. And what is this Western translator says, in spite of the pretensions, there is no evidence of any great empires in the Aitareya Brahmana. It's totally falsehood. He could say, they had the idea, but it probably didn't correspond to anything real, but to say that it didn't, and 16 are mentioned. Others are mentioned in Shatapata Brahmana. There's a whole set of emperors there. And then, of course, we have the evidence of Mahabharata itself, because in Mahabharata, Balaram takes a pilgrimage down the Saraswati to the Vinashana point. So that means at the time of Mahabharata, Saraswati wasn't totally gone. And we know at least by 1700 BC, it was gone. So geologically speaking, even Mahabharata is reflecting aspects of the geology of the Harappan period. Then, if we look at the artifacts of the Harappan civilization, the most common geometrical symbol they use is the swastika. Okay. They also have the peepal leaf. They have all the basic motifs of the Indian art. And they also have a lot of fire altars. Fire altars are common. And some of the fire altars are very common in a place called Kalibangan. And Kalibangan is very interesting because it's right at the confluence of what was called Saraswati and Drishadvati rivers, which in later times was said to be Kurukshetra, or the region of the Brahmins. Most common symbol is a one-horned young animal that's generally a bull, but sometimes it has horse-like or even rhinoceros-like characteristics. So some of the Western linguists have said, look, there are no horses on the seals, therefore they couldn't be Vedic people. Since 90% of the seals are unicorns, there are no unicorns in India, then they must have lived in a land where they were unicorns. In other words, their iconography was symbolic. It was not a zoological set of specimen. India, in any case, had the onager, or the ass of Kutch. So the equine animals were well known to them. And if we look at the symbolism of the writing, they have the chakra symbol is very common. We have very common the Pashupati, which is the yogi sitting in meditation pose with animals around him. And what do the leftist scholars say? Oh no, you can't identify him with Shiva. Shiva came so much later in time, we cannot connect these images. It could be some shamanic figure. Even though he has three heads and the same group of animals that he has later times. What is Mahabharata? We said the Mahabharata has the rivers, right? They also have the Saraswati River. In Mahabharata, they talk about Pashupata Yoga, and Shiva is not called Shiva. Predominantly, he's called Pashupati. The old yoga is also the always the Pashupata Yoga, the older Lakulish tradition. So even the symbols and the artifacts, we have a Vedic connection. And it's interesting because we have multi-headed animals in the symbols. We have animals with unusual body parts, like the tail of a snake and the arms of a deer, and then head of an elephant, things like that. But if you look at the iconography in Rigveda, you have the same thing. Not exactly in terms of the symbol, but you have like Chatuari Shringa, but with four horns, three feet, two heads, and seven hands. And the other one that's common is the three-humped bull. And the Trikakut, the three-humped bull, is a common symbol in Rigveda. And then there is a very interesting passage in Mahabharata that speaks of an earlier Nigantu and Nirukta, or set of texts on the meaning of words, and it mentions the Trikakut and the Ekashringa, the one-horned animal. Ekashringa is also called Vrishottama, or the supreme male, and it's sometimes identified as a bull, but it's also connected to the Varaha, or the boar. So there's adequate grounds of connecting that symbolism. And it's very interesting, if you look at Mahabharata, we talk about the avatars and their different animals, but what animal is Krishna most associated with in the Mahabharata? Varaha, the Varaha avatar. But that earlier Varaha, Ekashringa, has a connection even there with the Harappan ideas, whether that's Krishna or whether it's just a taking on of the iconography, that is something that remains to be seen. But the iconography and the connections are there. Another interesting thing we have is that you have what is called the Tiger Man in the Harappan seals. And some of the Western scholars say that must come later, because in the Vedas we have Narsimha, or the Lion Man. But Purusha Shardula, the Tiger Man, is in Mahabharata. And it's something also that Arjuna, that they are called to be like the tiger. In any case, the lion is there in Kutch in all respects. So the idea that they had to bring in lions and that reflected somewhere else. Bibi Lal has also done very good work on the archaeology, a whole half dozen books, former director of the Archaeological Survey of India. Yet his work is rejected by the Marxist scholars because they claim now he's a Hindutva scholar, and therefore anything he writes, even if he cites the archaeological evidence, should not be allowed because he is biased. And then he's also gone into the, I've looked at that too, the flora and the fauna of the Vedas. Peepal tree is common, Ashwata tree. So you know what the Western scholars say? Ashwata was originally the aspen tree in Central Asia, and when they came to India, they took that name and gave it to the Ashwata tree. So even if you have the evidence, then they negate the evidence by changing the meaning of terms in order to suit them. Climate is the seasons of India. Monsoon is a very big symbolism. In the Vedic text, you don't have a monsoon in Central Asia. Indra is the monsoon deity releasing the rivers. The monsoon is connected to the summer solstice, which is also when it occurs in India. So that the flora and the fauna are showing the same type of mainly tropical monsoon-based climate, extensive desert regions, but also tropical regions, giant trees. And what are the two sacred woods on which Agni is made? Ashwata and Chamali, the Shami tree. So these are two tropical woods to begin with. And then there's this whole issue of what we call the soma. This is something, I did a whole book on soma. This is also including its Ayurvedic and yogic meaning, and claiming that the Vedic people were, you know, taking this intoxicant, and the intoxicant, it was a primitive thing, and it was either bhang or ephedra that they took from Central Asia. So I did an extensive study of soma in the Rigveda and in other texts. in the Charak, in Sushrut Samhita, I think it is, 24 different types of somas are listed in their locations, and substitute somas. They exist in the mountains. They grow near mountain lakes. They have abundant milk and juice, and they're described as various orchid-type plants or lotus lily-type plants, and certain reed-type plants, so the types of plants. And there's many types of soma. And even if you study this sukta, this Vedic sukta, the Rigvedic sukta on the hymn to the plants, soma dwells in all the plants. Soma is the rasa, or the healing essence of the plants. And in the Vedic cosmology, for every agni, there's a soma. For the jatar agni, the food you eat is soma. So for the fire, the offering is the soma. Fire and water. See, spirit and matter, male and female. These are all also Agni Soma. In Shaivite literature, Shiva is said to be Agni Somatmakam, also Agni Soma and the sun and the moon. It's part of all pervasive cosmic symbolism like the yin and the yang. It is not just simply a particular plant. But it's very interesting. Where are the best somas found? On the Saraswati, Sharanyavat region, lakes in the Saraswati region. And it's interesting that about the disappearance of the soma and the disappearance of the Saraswati happen about the same time. And so what we see is that even the whole soma thing, and soma is a mountain plant, soma is brought by the eagle. And in the even Atharva Veda, the somas are connected to the Himalayas and to the East Himalayas. And they're brought down by the Ikshwakus, connected to Ikshwakus. Ikshwakus, Ikshwaku is also the reed or the sugar cane. So there's also the symbolism. And then the main Soma region, that says Soma belongs to all the five Vedic people and to these mountain regions, particularly areas like Kashmir. And in Sushrut, and in the Vedic literature and later literature, there's the two famous Manasa lakes. The lesser Manasa lake in Kashmir and the greater Manasa lake, which is Kailas by Manasarovar. And of course, Manasarovar is where these great rivers had their particular origin. And even now, the origins of the Saraswati are found. Mahabharata has them moving, has them going to the origin of the Saraswati, which is not far from the origin of Yamuna. There's this Harki Dune area that's been discovered for that. And then there's been some additional debate. Recently it was thought that we had originally thought that the Saraswati was a great river during Harappan times. Now they've discovered that during Harappan times, Saraswati was already a river in decline. So then they told us, this Western scholars said, then you've made a mistake. Obviously that's not your Saraswati. And then, but we look a little deeper, Harappa represents the late Vedic culture in which the river was in decline, like the time of Mahabharata. In fact, the Vinashana Saraswati has a whole strata in the literature, Manusmriti, some of the Brahmanas, it existed for a long time. And then the Vinashana Saraswati was largely the period of the Kurus. It started, Vinashana was there. In fact, the Purus left the Saraswati, came back, Kurus started again, and then the river started to decline from that point. So my feeling is that this is just more literary speculation, is that the Harappan culture and the Kuru predominant culture are pretty much the same, but there are other people, other groups throughout India. There was also the Yadus in the south, and Anus, Druyus, and so forth. So the ocean-going Saraswati represents an earlier period. They're also debating. Some of them said, there was enough water to fill the Saraswati River, and therefore it wasn't the Saraswati River you're talking about. Problem with that is the cities are there. The cities aren't going to be there if there's no water. The agriculture also requires the water. So even if the Harappan, even if the Saraswati was in decline in the Harappan era, that doesn't disprove the Vedic literature. Actually, it gives it a greater antiquity. There were some earlier also criticisms of the Vedic literature. They say Vedic literature mentions ayas or iron, and therefore it must come from later period. If we look at Rigveda, ayas is compared to Hiranya, or gold in luster. And in many of the other Indo-European languages, ayas means copper, or at most bronze. So ayas is obviously copper. Copper was a much earlier level. The main grain is yava, or barley, at an earlier phase. That's also there in Rigveda. And some of the later texts, as we move on, we have more complexity. What we have to understand is that the literature we have cannot be regarded as exhaustive of everything. The Rigveda has been preserved, but that doesn't mean there weren't other texts at that time. And we cannot look to what is essentially a spiritual religious text for every aspect of the life of the people. If a plant is not mentioned in the Rigveda, people didn't know about it. That is ridiculous. So some of the other Vedic texts have more information about plants and other things. In fact, now we know that iron technology, India was one of the main sources of that. Steel also came from India. And then the other interesting thing they found out is that in the 15th century in Syria, there was a group of people called the Mitanni who had Sanskritic names and the Sanskritic language. So part of the Aryan invasion scenario is that this was the Vedic people on their way to India. It has several problems. One, they had a literature, for example, of manuals of training horses, which was almost in pure Sanskrit. Two, they were a nobility. They were the Maryada. They were the noble kings and aristocracy of the region. They weren't nomads at all. They weren't primitive people at all. They were the highest level of the aristocracy. They were also related Indo-European people, what they were connected with, like Hittites, Kassites, also were ruling Mesopotamia at that particular time. And all of them appear as urban, princely elite, not as any primitive people. And if we trace the movement, we see these people are always moving to the west. They're not going to the east. And they continued there as well. And even later, when the Persians and the Scythians came in, they were also groups and connected to all these people. And not only that, the Sanskrit they were using appears to be a later Sanskrit, not an earlier Sanskrit. They are mentioning Vedic gods like Indra, Mitra, Varuna, Agni, and so forth. But it's clear that we have room for people moving outside of India as well. And it's also interesting that the closer they are to India, the more Vedic the culture is, the further away they are, Vedic tends to be removed. And we find in the Vedic literature, this is where we have scholarly hypocrisy of the highest order. Michael Witzel quoted a verse from the Baudhyayana Shrauta Sutra that talked about the people moving east, moving from the Saraswati River. Kurus, Panchalas, Kanshi, Kosala, Videha went east, and Parshavas, Gandharas, and Aratas went west. And he misinterpreted the place. He said, from their place in the west. The place was the Saraswati River, obviously. Romila Thapar still quotes that verse, even though it's regarded as his Sanskrit was wrong and he had to remove that. And so they say one group went west and the others went east when the Saraswati dried up. Gandharas, we know, Afghanistan. Parshavas, the Persians there. They were sometimes connected. And it's interesting, if you study the Zend Avesta, the homeland of the Persians is Balkh or Bactria, not the west. And Balkh is also mentioned in the Atharva Veda and other texts. The Persian name for fire is Atar, priests are Atharvas. So they went, and Arata was the name they used to call that part of Syria and Turkey, even today, Urartu, Arata. So we have even literary evidence of the westward movement of those people involved. And on top of that, this level of communication did not come to an end, communication, dissemination of culture. There was ongoing trade. It's known that the Sumerians had ongoing trade with India. Babylonians, all those cultures had ongoing trade. The arts, the weights and measurements of the Harappan culture on the island of the weights and measurements on the island of Bahrain were those of the Harappan culture of India, not those of the Sumerians. And a lot of the Indic things were there, including things like cotton was traded and other things like that. So there was also a dissemination via ideas and culture via trade, and also going back and forth, these places were connected. And we find that that connection continued through history. The Greeks, it wasn't the first time people from West were in India, or vice versa. There were, of course, colonies of the Vaishyas in Alexandria and the other cities of Europe, of the Near East, and also Mesopotamia. And this is a very interesting point people don't realize. We think of the European peoples, you don't realize that the dominant peoples throughout Central Europe, Eastern Europe, were Iranian people in terms of languages. The Scythians, the Shakas, were the dominant people of the Central Asian region, which is now, of course, this Uzbekistan and Turkestan. They were also the dominant people of Ukraine and southern Russia. They had kingdoms all the way down into the Danube. And one of their offshoots, the Sarmatian people, actually became the nobility of the Merovingian kings of France. They were also there. Scythians were in the armies, and there were Scythian mercenaries in the Roman army in England. And even at a much earlier time, there were Scythian mercenaries in the Pharaoh's army in the 8th century, in 8th century BCE in Egypt. Now, when they did studies of the cultures and the ethnicities of people, not only in Central Asia, but also in Eastern China, which is now this Tarim Basin, they found that they were mainly Iranian people and Iranian languages there, going back, and the mummies were also Iranian, Indo-European type, more so than Mongolian people. And we know historically that Central Asia was predominantly Iranian until the 8th century. That was the time the Turks moved in and took over that region and pushed the Iranian people away. And we have a very interesting phenomenon where we had the Indo-Scythian kingdoms, the Shakas, and the Kushanas, who were great patrons of Buddhism. In fact, the Kushanas were also connected, I think, even to Sanchi, right? And they had a kingdom, not only kingdoms in North India. When the Kushanas and Indo-Scythians were ruling Punjab, they were ruling Central Asia all the way to the Danube. When we went to Bulgaria, they also have a historical record of their connection to Afghanistan and the peoples of that region. And the Thracian people, who were the most numerous people in ancient Europe, the Greeks considered them to be their gurus. There's some debate about their language, but there's the dominant opinion is was Iranian language. We went to visit some of their ruins, and they did the burial of the king with the chariot and the horse and all of that. So in other words, and then the Scythians there were also then carrying on the Silk Trail from China to Rome. So in other words, those type of communication was going on all along. That's why that's how even Buddhism and Hindu thought could move throughout the Silk Trail, even 2,000 years ago. So these people were never isolated or separated, and there was often this movement of ideas from India to these other countries and cultures in the world. But what we can also see is some of these ancient cultures, besides the Hittites and the Mitanni, the Greeks were of the ancient Greeks, the early Greeks were of that similar period. They had many customs in harmony with India, temple worship, including murtis, including using candles, flowers, all those things. They also had very similar deities, Surya, the sun god. We were in Rome recently, and the healers were the Ashwins of the Dioscuri. In the Vedic thought, the Ashwins are the primal healers relative to the Ayurveda as well. They had the planetary temples and the worship of the astrology. The earlier Greek philosophy the pre-Socratics like Parmenides, Heraclitus, they had not only the worship of fire, they had this kind of idea of pure being as the ground of existence. Similar philosophies. We also had the Druids, the Celtic Druids, who were often called the Brahmins of that regions. You had certain similar ideas of worship and spirituality in those cultures as well. But even beyond that, if we look at the cultures of Egypt and Mesopotamia, they had many connections, not with India, trade with India, and we also have connections of the pharaohs of Egypt marrying into the Mitanni families, who had this Sanskritic language. And throughout Mesopotamia, you had similar mythology as you had, or stories, flood story, sacred plant story, that you had in India as well. So again, we shouldn't divide people off simply by language alone. The Egyptians had a solar religion. They had the cobra, the falcon, a lot of the lotus. They had many symbols similar to those of India as well. So there was always that movement of trade and ideas going on throughout the entire region, and also historically. So when the Greeks came to India, what did they say? They didn't say we're coming to a primitive place. For them, and the Greeks, like Alexander, said they thought India was a very advanced civilization. And there was one of their authors named Megasthenes. He did a book called Indica. It hasn't survived. But one of its passages said he came about the time of Alexander, that he found a history in India of 153 kings going back more than 6,400 years. And this is a very interesting concept he has, because we have the Kali Yuga calendar that began at 3,100 BC, ended, and then we have that ending of that calendar 3,600 years later. What Megasthenes found was evidence of an earlier calendar of 3,600 years, from 6,700 years to 3,100 BCE, which is also well into the pre-Harappan era. And in the Puranas, in the Vedas, we have lists of kings. Puranic king lists are over 100, well, there's well over 100 kings before the time of Buddha anyway, maybe even close to 150, I don't know the exact numbers involved. India has the longest king list of any culture in the world, much longer than the Egyptians. In the Bible, they only have 42 kings between what, Abraham and Jesus, 42 rulers. So the literature of the kings is also there, and the places they were. And then we have also astronomical references in Vedic text. In the earlier times, they talked about, you know, India, you have this solely lunar calendar, like these months, you know, Chaitra, you just had all this, all these Navaratri things where you have the nakshatra-based month, Ashwin, the Ashwini, based on the nakshatra. You have the same type of calendar and evidence in Vedic text. And you also have different types of years, won't go into all that, but you have references to earlier dates of solstices and equinox. Atharvaveda, and one of the last book, has a very interesting hymn. They start out the list of nakshatras with Kritika, and then they use the term Ayana, which means solstice, and the Ayana is Magga. If when Kritika is the wind, is the vernal equinox, Ayana is the summer solstice, is in Magga. That it can be very easily dated to a period of around 2500 to 2000 BCE. We have a lot of references to Kritika equinox and even to ones before them. So that information is there. Unfortunately, there are some people in the Hindu movement itself who are looking at dates so early astronomically that they're discrediting the more solid dates that we do have. But even Varaha Mihira, when he has his Brihat Jataka, no, this would be the Brihat Samhita, where he's discussing the astronomy, he says currently the vernal equinox is in these Punarvasu. Previously, he said in the ancient text, not the vernal equinox, the summer solstice. Previously in the ancient text, it was in Ashlesha. Ashlesha would have been a date of around 1500 BC. He had remembered that, but even earlier we have it in other places. So then the Aitareya Brahmana, they talk about the winter solstice relative to Magga, and again a date of at least 1500 BC. So what does the Western translator say? Hindus aren't good astronomers even today. Why should we trust that they were good astronomers even then? This information has absolutely no value whatsoever. Yet if we read the text, they also speak of, but how can you have a calendar that doesn't work? How could you be following a watch that is no longer running? We have ample evidence. Again, the 27 times 27 nakshatras. India also had the decimal system, the mathematics, and Indian astronomy, astrology doesn't follow the mathematical calculations of the Greeks. They have their own. They didn't get the mathematics from the Greeks, so how did they get the other things from them, as we are told? So in other words, we have the mathematics and the astronomy as well. So the evidence shows the indigenous culture in India. Vedas are a good representative of that. We wouldn't say there was no other literature, there were no other people, there were no other movements. And even Vedas are highly synthetic, with a number of different gotras, number of different families, deities are represented. They're obviously very inclusive of a very, very vast tradition. So we have that evidence of the Vedic culture. There's still some of this linguistic argument that's hard to deal with, because they change the rules of the game when they no longer win the game. But the progress is being made. But again, the Indian view of the leftists is to negate the thing altogether rather than to address the topic. So now they say, oh, it's not important. It's not important anymore. Or Romila Thapa says, I don't accept the invasion anymore. Then she turns it into a migration. Be a question on why aren't the migrants found? Oh, they didn't need to be found because they came. And it's, well, how, that's not proof. Well, it's when you have to eliminate the need. Eliminating the need for evidence is not proof of your statement. It shows that your theory is weak. And unfortunately, in the last Congress government, they brought all the leftists and Marxists back into ICHR and let them rewrite the history of India one more time. I even remember talking to one of the Congress MPs, I won't mention the name, saying that, yes, we believe we are proud of the antiquity of the Vedas, but it's politically advantageous for us to maintain otherwise in order to get the Dalit vote or Marxist vote or whatever else that we need. The Aryan myth is still going on. The Europeans would still like to be the original Aryans. The Germans would like it. The Russians would also like to have that title for themselves, so they are not giving up on nationalistic grounds. The Dravidians still want the Aryans to be outsiders, even though the oldest Sangam literature mentions Aryas and calls them people Aryas and connects them to Yadus. So what do? They say, well, there was actually an earlier Sangam literature that said they weren't, but we don't have that anymore. Again, invent evidence that you no longer have. Look at the Dravidian language. If we study the origins of the Dravidian language, it's taught by sage Agastya, and by which he learns also from Kumar Subramanya. Now, who is Kumar Subramanya? He is Agni, who is Vak in the Vedas. Agastya has 25 suktas in the Rigveda itself. He is the elder brother of Vasishta, who is the foremost of the Vedic rishis. So I've also argued a southern connection for the Vedas because of this maritime connection and connection with the rishis. But everything that says about the origin of Tamil can also be given to the origin of Sanskrit. And there's no difference of the mythology or the teachers and the figures involved. And people can invent more than one language. Ancient people were multilingual. They could also have more than one language. We have been laboring under wrong ways of knowledge. These things like comparative mythology and linguistics prove the theories of the people who have invented these systems of knowledge, and without hard evidence, they have no basis. So In closing, I would say it's very important that we emphasize the geological and the archaeological evidence first, because that is very solid. Even the genetic evidence is pretty good. Literary evidence is also in our favor, and because the other people have to say, everything you're quoting of this greatness that's in the Vedic culture is an interpolation that was put in later. That's one of their other things. Again, negate the evidence that you don't have the original text. In the original text, it wasn't there. Well, you weren't around there either. How can you say what was in the original text in any case? So we have to produce the evidence. We don't need to be emotional about it. We can bring out some of the political ramifications, but it's interesting. No theory in the history of the world has been used for more political advantage and destruction than this theory. And yet when Hindu groups or even non-Hindu groups question the Aryan movement into India, they are called politically biased and fundamentalist, whereas the Nazis, the Marxists, the Dravidian nationalists, Russian, German nationalists have all used this theory for political mileage. It does have political ramifications, but really not much. Why should it be a problem for people today if people in India 5,000 years ago had a connection to the Vedic culture, or the Vedas were a record from that particular place? Even in Greece, which is a Christian, strongly Christian country, they do not reject their pagan past. It's only basically Islamic countries that tend either to reject their pagan past or turn them into earlier forms of Islam. So in India, you don't have to become a Hindu today to accept the fact that these Vedic teachings were there, just as you don't have to become a Hindu today to honor Sanskrit or to honor what is else that is going on in this country. There has been a concerted movement to denigrate the native culture of India. It happened throughout the world. Native Americans were totally denigrated. We grew up with the image of Native Americans as massacring poor white immigrants. The opposite occurred. The white immigrants and armies massacred the poor Native Americans. It's time for that colonial scenario to change. India is the only country that's maintaining the colonial anti-Native scenario of its own culture, even though it has the most magnificent of the native cultures and has been able to preserve its native culture best. So that is why this issue needs to be addressed and to be changed, even though for an open-minded person, it is fairly clear that the old scenario doesn't work. And finally, I was told by some of the Western scholars, yes, we know our Aryan scenario is incorrect, but we don't know what else to put there, and until we do, we're going to leave it there, because something needs to be there. So we will have a talk at JNU on the 6th. Bharat will also be there. We'll discuss this further. I did the yearly talk for ICHR this year. You can get that online for their Foundation Day lecture on this topic. We, of course, harassed or attacked by the left for doing that. I have been promoting this idea, and I want to promote it here also. It's time for India to move into the post-colonial, post-Marxist era and revive its estimation of its own history and culture accordingly. There's only one country in the world where Marxists are still writing or determining textbooks. That is in India. They never did a good job anywhere else, even in the countries that they rule. They're even much worse in the countries that they rule. Why would you think that they've done a good job in India? India is a spiritual country. Marxists are atheists, we know. They have their own political agenda. Why should they be given that? The Marxist era ended in 1991. We no longer need Brenda Carrot and Sitaram Yechury and these people telling us what to do and what is humanism, and we don't need their lackeys and television dictating morality in India and telling us who are the biased people. Nowhere in the world did the Marxists produce an objective view of history. They destroyed art, they destroyed culture. Marxists destroyed more of native Chinese culture than the British did, and Marxists have discredited more of the native Indian culture even than the British did. It is time that we move beyond their influence, which is what we are aiming to do. Not that there's nothing of any value in their ideas or their scholarship, but they did not have the tools to understand texts like the Vedas. Later we'll talk about the spiritual basis of the Vedas, because that is also there. Vedas are reflecting a deeply spiritual and philosophical culture of great profundity, depth, and antiquity, not simply these primitive invaders from the outside. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.